Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Gaming on Caffeine. My name is Isaac, and we are back with a brand new mod pack. Today, we are starting a series on the Crack Pack, which is nowhere near as obscene as it sounds. It's a mod pack developed by the Feed the Beast team, available right now on the Curse and Feed the Beast launchers for the Minecraft team. They're a group of YouTubers who make stuff on YouTube and also on Twitch and other places like that. I should probably say right off the bat, I am not a member or affiliated in any way with the Minecraft team, but they released this pack onto the Feed the Beast and Curse launcher. It looks like a pretty cool pack, and so I thought I'd play it. It's basically a kitchen sink 1.7.10 pack, so nothing incredibly new, but I was looking through my YouTube channel the other day, and it has been about 9 months now since I started a non-Skyblock kitchen sink mod pack. And for those who are unfamiliar with the term kitchen sink, it's essentially a mod pack that has a bunch of mods thrown together, and you can just do what you like, kind of like a kitchen sink. If you go up to a kitchen sink that's full of dishes, you can start where you like. You know, you don't have to start with the pot on top, you can go right down and clean the forks at the bottom if you'd like, or you can clean on the top and work your way down. You can do what you want. And that's essentially the theme or the idea behind the term kitchen sink mod pack. There is no line of progression. There is no quest book or guidebook or anything really telling you in which direction to go with this mod pack. Much like a bunch of mod packs. Mod packs like Feed the Beast Infinity Evolved, the non-Skyblock version. The Skyblock version is kind of a kitchen sink pack because you don't have to do anything in a particular way, but it does have a guidebook and it does kind of have a set line of progression that you somewhat have to follow. It's kind of like a pseudo kitchen sink pack, if you will. But this is a full-on kitchen sink pack. There is no line of progression whatsoever. You can do what you want, when you want, and that is exactly what I am going to do. And the main reason that I'm playing this is just because it has been so long since I last played a kitchen sink mod pack that wasn't a Skyblock. It's been so long since I've just played some vanilla modded Minecraft, if that makes sense. Some modded Minecraft that doesn't have, like, a spin on it, doesn't have a gimmick, nothing like that. Don't get me wrong, I enjoy those gimmicky mod packs, and the other series on my channel are not going anywhere anytime soon, but I want to mix things up a little bit, and I want to play a good old kitchen sink mod pack for all time's sake. I'll put a link in the description to where you can get the Curse of Feed the Beast launcher if you would like to play along, and I'll also put the seed that I used in the world type and stuff if you would like to play along with that as well in the exact same world on the exact same pack. And the reason why I say that is because we've started in a really nice place, at least I think so. We've got a nice forest biome. I'm a big fan of starting in forests. We've got a lovely little river here right next to this beautiful little house, which I'm hoping contains some cool stuff. And then if you look on the minimap, we also, if you look kind of up here, we also have like a volcano over in that direction. I don't know if we can quite see it from where we are. Yeah, you can kind of see the top of it just over there. And we got a volcano nearby, so that should be a fairly good source of early game lava. And then just over in the distance on the minimap again, past that new house over there, we have a little village. So we have an awful lot of really... No... So we've got a lot of cool stuff right here at the spawn. I was really happy when I found this spawn. I did cycle through a couple of deserts and, like, way too many snow biomes. I don't know why, but snow biomes, they come up way too often. They're like every single biome. It's crazy. But anyway, we'll start out. We've got ourselves some wood here. I want to start by checking out that, that house nearby. Because if this has got some cool stuff in it, I'll be very happy. It doesn't look like a normal villager house, and it's not like any house that I've seen before. I'm not quite sure on what mod adds it, and wow, that village is a lot closer than I thought as well. We might go and check that out real quick as well. But what is in here? We should harvest these. They are going to keep us full for quite some time. You should probably get used to me eating blueberries and raspberries, because those are some of my favorite things to eat when I do series like this. They're so easy to grow, so easy to turn into juice. It just makes life so much easier. But over here, we've got, what is this? So I didn't build this, by the way. It was just, it's like naturally spawning here. It might be actually, ooh, it might be part of Runic Dungeons? Is that the right mod? I know there is a dungeon mod. Yeah, look at this. So it is a mod that adds dungeons to the game. And so we should go check that out at some point as well. But I know from experience that I should not go and check that out just yet. That will be full of deadly mobs and mob spawners that I do not want to fight against. Unfortunately, no coal in there, which is a bit of a shame. Is there anything upstairs? It's looking pretty barren. I guess we could take mushrooms. Like, that could be useful. We've got some carpet. Ooh, we do have a chest. Oh, okay. That... Ooh, I can get down with this. All right, so we got a bunch of enchanted armor. Wow, okay, I will take that. Statistics by Grim Merc. What the heck is this? What? Oh, is it just... Oh, it's from... Oh, okay, so it's just telling us about the house? The house and the dungeon? There's 101 TNT down there? All right, I mean, I'm not wholly interested in that. We will take... There's no point in me taking the other axe, because I've got Efficiency 2 and Unbreaking 1 on this axe already. I'll take the paper and I'll take the books, just because I might need them for crafting. I'm not too bothered about the bones. We can probably get more bones fairly easily. I'll take the shovel, just because we don't have one. Do I want the fish? Yeah, we'll take the cooked fish. We can eat that. We can eat the apples. I will also take the spider eye and the wheat just in case we need that as well. Let's go ahead and eat this fish. And that looks about it. We can't sleep, unfortunately, yet because it's not nighttime. I would like to sleep because nighttime is approaching and I'd like to not respawn in the middle of the woods. I also have not yet turned on keep inventory or turned off mob griefing, but I probably will do both of those things at some point throughout the series because I don't like having to go and find... Ooh, that is... We probably shouldn't have jumped now. We could have died very easily, but I'm not a huge fan of, like, scavenging to get all my stuff back after I died, but look at this. I'm also not quite sure what mod adds the, like, custom villages. Like, this is not a default village, I don't think. I'm fairly certain that's not a vanilla village building. So, what do we have here? I would very much like to get maybe an emerald. They do kind of drop emeralds every now and again, but I will definitely take all of this food if they don't mind, which I'm assuming they probably will, but that's fine. We'll take all this food. That should keep us going for quite a while here, because we're of course going to have to go on our preliminary mining trip, and I would very much like to not starve to death whilst I'm down there, so I will take absolutely all of this. What I will probably end up doing, actually, is camping out in that little house we found until we set up our own actual base, because I want to dump all this stuff out. Ooh, what is this? We got, like, a brick-roofed house? What? Is this like an immersive engineering house? I have to assume it is. Actually, let me craft this up into planks here so as not to waste a bit of wood. Could you move? But I think this must be an immersive engineering house. We've got the immersive engineering hammer, and then we've got treated wood all around. What are you selling? You are selling... Oh, my goodness. Okay. No. Okay. Well, he does not want me to enter his village house, apparently. It also looks like we've got a Pam's Harvestcraft garden here. Yeah, a bunch of stuff. I'm not going to pick any of this stuff up yet because that would just destroy my inventory entirely. But I think that's the first time that I have ever been attacked by an iron golem. We didn't even... Did I attack the villager? I don't think I attacked the villager. Did I hit the one that was in front of the door? I don't think I did. Did I? I'm pretty sure I didn't. Anyway, let's come back over here. Let's just break our way through here. Let's get some sleep so that we can respawn in this bed. I'll make myself a chest. We should probably start off with some Tinker's tools. Yeah, we'll build down here. We do have Tinker's construct, so I'll get rid of this crafting station. I'll get rid of this crafting table and craft it into a crafting station. There we go. All right, so we can use that. Let's get some chests here. It's so nice to be in the non-expert mode again. Like, I've been playing Feed the Beast Infinity Evolved Skyblock expert mode recently, and everything is just so much harder. Like, you usually get 2 planks per piece of wood there. And so I'm hoping that this will be a nice breath of fresh air. It'll be so much easier than what I've been doing recently. So let's, like, put away most of this stuff. We should probably put our armor on. We've only got 1 chest plate. Which is better here? We've got surplus pantaloons of defense, and then surplus pantaloons of warding. So, Unbreaking 2 and Died, Unbreaking 1 and Protection 2. I feel like these ones are going to last longer, but I feel like that Protection 2 is better than lasting longer. They're going to, like, protect me a bit more. I probably should have put those on before we started fighting with the Iron Golem. We can also get rid of these flower pots. Probably don't need the mushrooms just yet. We'll also craft this wheat up into some bread real quick. There we go. Carrots we can keep on us for now. Apples are all good. And that looks all pretty good. It looks pretty good. We'll get rid of the mushroom, and we'll keep a hold of everything else for now. Cool stuff. All right, let's get some sleep, and then let's look at making some basic Tinker's tools, at which point... Oh, there are monsters nearby? Are they outside? They are probably just outside. At which point, once I've got my Tinker's tools, I'll probably cut away and do a nice amount of mining so that we've got... Oh, gosh, yeah, look at these guys. All right, how good's this sword? Yeah, all right, I would say by the looks of things, it looks like we're going to be able to keep them off, but this is not anywhere near as good as I was hoping it was going to be. He should be dead. We do have the morph mod, apparently. I was not aware. Let's... Oh, no, 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 no. I died. Flippin' heck. All right. So this is where we actually spawn. My death point, thankfully, has showed up in the world there. We're not too far away from where our house is. That's the spawn, by the way, if you're playing along. So the house should just be over here. I'm not quite sure if the items... Ooh, could you not? I'm also fairly certain we have gravestones turned on. So all of my stuff should... just be set outside the house waiting for me. But then again, also, there is probably a zombie nearby. Oh, let's get inside. Okay. I'm not quite sure if the, like, inventory of these chests is written into the seed, or whether or not you are going to get, like, different stuff in that chest if you spawn in the exact same world. I'm not quite sure. Where are these zombies at? Come on. I want to sleep. I want to sleep, and you're stopping me sleeping. But yeah, I'm thinking about getting some Tinker's tools. Before I start with some basic stuff like some iron, and then, oh my goodness, where? Let's move this. I'm going to move this to, like, the other side of the room and see if that allows us to sleep, maybe? Nope. Maybe. Oh, it's probably because we're above the dungeon, actually. Now that I think about it, I don't think it's going to matter where I put this, because there is probably a fair amount of zombies down here. This is probably where the noise is coming from. Although, I'd assume that these guys were far enough away to not cause me any problems. Also, there is a ton of brick here. I might actually just salvage, like, going down there, there's a lot of brick on the walls. I might just, like, salvage all of this and use it for my initial base. Like, just completely tear down this house and start from scratch. Can I sleep, please? Yay, there we go. Okay, cool. So once we've slept, all the mobs should now die. And now, let's have a look at crafting up some tinker stuff. So for this, we're going to need to make a bunch of blank patterns, which shouldn't be all too hard. Let's just go ahead. And apparently those were wooden shears? Is that a thing? Thermal foundation? I guess it is. I'm going to try those out. I have not seen those before. But let's go ahead. Let's make ourselves a couple of these blank patterns. And then we can craft those up with an oak wooden plank to get a stencil table. We can craft it with the log to get a part builder. And then I think the last one is a crafting table. You can also craft it with the chest to get the pattern storage. But for now, we only really need these three for the time being. So let's go ahead and put those down. We're running out of space already, aren't we? Jeez. Let's get rid of this stuff here. I didn't know that was going to get rid of the cake. I should have kept that. But let's put this stuff down here. I don't want to get rid of the bed just yet, even though it's kind of in the way, because that's mostly where I want to sleep. Where are you at? This is an angry zombie from Thormcraft. It's actually a furious zombie. Oh my god, it's massive! What the heck? But we killed it. That's good. Alright, let's turn off our death point here. Let's remove that. I kind of want to try my wooden shears here. We should probably get these zombie brains just in case we need them later on down the line for some Thormcrafty stuff. I want to try shearing a sheep real quick with these wooden shears, because I can't imagine that they are really that good. And if they are, then I don't see why you'd get iron shears. Are they just less durable? Is that the idea here? Because they look like they're exactly the same. That is crazy. Don't get me wrong, I like it. I hate having to get, like, iron shears. It seems like a waste of iron, but sure. Alright, the wooden shears. First piece of... Oh my goodness, why are there so many furious zombies? It's crazy. You'll also notice the rubber trees everywhere. These are all from Industrial Craft 2. We'll probably get into something from Industrial Craft 2 later on down the line. I feel like we need to move pretty soon because there are so many of those massive furious zombies. That is ridiculous. But anyway, let's see about getting ourselves like a simple pickaxe. So we, first of all, should make a normal pickaxe and get some cobblestone, because I don't really see the point in making a tinker's pickaxe that's wooden. So do we want to dig just in here? I don't really want to dig just in here. Instead, I would much prefer to kind of dig maybe here. Yeah, this seems like a much better place to dig. So we'll dig a little bit here. We'll get some cobblestone. And then once we've got a good few pieces of that, do we have any sugarcane nearby? Because it would be pretty cool if we could make the binding out of paper. Because that would allow us, I think, to get an extra modifier onto our pickaxe. Unfortunately, I was really hoping there'd be some sugarcane kind of just on the edge of this little pseudo river that we have here. We could go and check out that other big river. Like, there are much larger rivers and probably, like, an ocean almost over there that we could check out, and they might have some sugarcane. Because for those who are unaware, the when you add paper, when one of your parts in a tinker's tool is made of paper, it gives you the writable effect, which allows you to have an extra modifier on there as well. It does decrease the durability, I believe, but that extra modifier could be pretty cool. And here we go. Look at this. Flipping paper. All right, beautiful. So I'm thinking we start out with a real basic pickaxe. We're going to grab a stone head, a wooden rod, and then just a paper binding. That should give us the writable effect, which means we can add more stuff later on down the line. I'm not quite sure if we have iguana tweaks installed, so I'm not sure if we're going to be able to level up our pickaxe as we use it and get new modifiers for free. I'm going to assume by default that we don't have it, and I just went the longest way around getting into there, but let's have a look. So if we throw in our... We're going to need more blank patterns, actually, real quick. So let's just craft all that up, and then let's get a few more of those. Four should be fine. So in our stencil table, let's throw all those in there. First of all, we're going to want to get a pickaxe head, which is this guy. We're also going to need a... I don't think we need the tool rod cast, because as people have pointed out to me over and over and over again, you can just use a stick. You don't have to actually craft the stick into a tool rod. It doesn't have to be made like that. But we're going to have a pickaxe head that is made of cobblestone. We're going to have a binding that is hopefully made from paper. So let's go just craft that up real quick as well. Actually, we had paper, didn't we? We have it in this chest. Flipping, we've already got the paper, jeez. But let's go ahead and craft that up and see if that works. I'm thinking it does. You'll see there it says writable, which I believe gives us an extra modifier. So if we come over here, we want a pickaxe, we want a writable paper binding, the stone pickaxe head, and then just a stick. Yeah, okay, so that gets us the stone pickaxe. You'll see it says modifiers remaining 4. That means we can add up to 4 modifiers onto the pickaxe to improve it in a multitude of different ways. And the base amount of modifiers you get with a new tool is 3. So the paper has worked. The paper has given us an extra modifier there. And so what I'm going to do is I'm just going to dump everything into the chest here. By the way, spacebar and left click if you want to pull out like an inventory's worth of stuff all at once. But I'm going to dump all of that in there. I'm going to get rid of the shears as well. I don't think there's anything else in there I need. I'll take my shovel just in case we come across any kind of dirt. But other than that, that looks pretty good. So what I'm going to do now, guys, I'm going to go away. I'm going to do a bunch of mining. Actually, we should really get some torches before we leave. So let me actually cut down a couple of trees here. I kind of like the fact that we were given this pickaxe right off the bat, but we should get some torches. And essentially, I'm going to go away. I'm going to do a bunch of mining, try and get as much stuff as I can. And I'll be back in a second. And we'll start with some early game audibling. We are going to make a smeltery just so we can make better tinker's tools, but I'm not going to use the smeltery for my... Ooh, there were so many gaps in the floor. But I'm not going to use my smeltery for early game audibling because I feel like I always use the Tinker smeltery for early game audibling. I don't really want rubber wood. I just want normal stuff. So yeah, we're going to go away and get some stuff. I'll come back. I'll craft up the smeltery once we get enough sand, gravel, and clay, which shouldn't be too hard because we've got this river there, which kind of hopefully will contain the hardest part to get, which is usually clay. We should have quite a lot of clay around thanks to all the lakes. But we'll get that. We'll make the smeltery. And then I'll also start working on some other kind of ore doubling. But let's throw you into there. And we should probably use just normal oak planks as the fuel because they burn for about the same amount of time. But obviously, you get 4 planks per log, so it's a bit more efficient fuel-wise. But I'm going to go away. I'm going to make some torches. I'm going to go mining for a little bit. And I'll be back in a second. Okay, so a little while later, I've been mining. I've got quite a bit of stuff, mostly iron and coal, but also a little bit of tin, copper, aluminium, and a fair bit of apatite as well. There was a ton of apatite in a nearby cave. I started off by just mining down here, but we kind of hit the runic dungeon beneath this house pretty quickly, and so I decided to go and look on the other side of the river, and you can see over there, I've got quite a few death points. On the plus side, I got 2 enderpearls out of it, though. I found 2 endermen almost straight away and managed to kill them both. The second one did kind of beat me first, but I got to it afterwards and managed to kill it, and we got 2 nice early game enderpearls, which are going to come in really useful early on, because one of the things that I'm usually really bad at getting really early on is enderpearls, so we'll take those. I'm going to rearrange things a little bit here, just because what I want to do now is start making a Tinker's Construct smeltery, because to start mining some of the lower level items like redstone, diamonds, etc., we're going to need a better pickaxe, and the one that we've got right now can only mine at the mining level iron. You'll see there, like, kind of close to the middle bottom, it says mining level iron, which means we cannot mine anything higher tier than iron, like obsidian, diamond, redstone, etc. And so to do that, we're going to have to make a better pickaxe, which is most likely going to be an iron pickaxe, so we can mine some redstone and diamonds. And to do that, we are going to make a Tinker's Construct smeltery. We could just make a normal vanilla iron pickaxe, but I would much rather prefer to have one that I can repair so I don't have to keep wasting iron on making a new pickaxe every time. The same reason why I made this one. Unfortunately, we do not have iguana tweaks installed, which means you do not level up your item as it goes along, but that's fine. Let's go ahead and craft all of this up like that. Maybe it's the other way around. I thought this was a shapeless crafting recipe. But, oh no, it's because these are not blocks. Okay, let's craft these up into blocks real quick. If we do something like that, and then that's going to get us 9 of those. Not quite enough to use all of the gravel and sand that we got, but that should, I think, be more than enough to actually make ourselves a beginner smeltery. And it does take a little bit of time here, basically. We're going to smelt this grout into some seared brick. We're going to use that seared brick to make all of the parts of the smeltery. And so to speed this up a little bit, I'm basically going to use all of my cobblestone here to make a bunch of furnaces, and then just set up like a bit of a furnace wall over here to make this go a little bit faster. Actually, I kind of want that to be a bit more symmetrical, even though it is just kind of a half-baked furnace wall. There we go. Look at that. Beautiful. We've even got this one that's turned to the side in the middle there. Not quite sure if that's of any use whatsoever, but let's quickly dump most of our stuff here into this chest. I don't want to use my coal just yet for these furnaces, because I kind of want to use that for some early game power. How many do we have? 5, 7. So if we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and then maybe the same again. Yeah, there we go. That evens it out nicely, and we can go ahead and put 13 into each of these, and then spread out the workload here of the grout. Let's change that up so they both have close to 13. We'll spread that out, and now we can do the exact same thing with the grout. We could spread that out again across 7 inventory slots like that. I'm going to go away. I'm going to wait until all of these have smelted up, and I'll be back in a second. Okay, so a little while later, I did some calculations, and we weren't quite going to have enough of these seared bricks here to make a basic smeltery, and so I went away, got a little bit more clay, and started smelting that up as well. So, we could pretty much grab almost all of this out of the smeltery here, and we are getting quite a nice amount of XP as well at the same time. I'll leave the rest to smelt up. We should have enough here with a stack and 44 to make a full basic smeltery. You can make a really small 1x1 smeltery, but I'm not a huge fan of that. You can't put a whole lot in it, and so I would rather go for the basic 3x3 smeltery. And the way we make that is starting off with the smeltery controller, which looks something like this. We also need a drain, which looks something like that. We're also going to need a tank, which requires a piece of glass. So let's throw you in there, as well as a casting table, which looks like that. A faucet, which looks something like that. And then, of course, that tank we were talking about, which is just exactly the same as a controller, but with the glass in the middle like so. And I think that that is pretty much everything we need to get a basic Tinker's Construct smeltery up and running. I'm not going to try and build it in here because this place is tight enough as it is. So, for now, let's, like, I guess, chop down this tree and build it, like, right here. What I'll probably end up doing between episodes is building, like, a beginner base to get a little house for us with enough space to put all of this stuff in. Because I usually end up just kind of sitting outside if I don't build a base. Anyone who watches any of my previous series is like Modded Survival Island or anything before that will know that I tend to just sit out in the wild until I get a house, and so I would very much like to get one of those built pretty quick here. And we are going to need quite a lot of these seared bricks as well. How many are we going to need? I think 18 of these seared bricks in total is what we need, which is perfectly the amount that we had. I guess we have some extra seared bricks there, but if you ignore those, we were pretty much bang on there. So let's go ahead and throw down a casting table like that underneath the smeltery drain. We'll put the faucet on the drain. We could do with a shovel here, actually. I made a really basic wooden shovel just so I could dig up a little bit more clay whilst I was out and about. We already burned through that initial cobblestone shovel that we got from our chest upstairs in the building by just getting all of the sand and gravel that we needed to make all of this seared brick. But if we do something like this, not like that, you want to make sure that is on the outside like so, that gets us a very basic Tinker's Construct smeltery. And basically what this does, for those who don't know, is it smelts down metals into a liquid form, and then you can use those to craft up other metals like alloys if you craft certain ones together. Oh, what happened there? That didn't sound like it was for me, but I'm a little bit scared. So I want to make an iron pickaxe, and to do that, we're going to have to get a pickaxe head cast so that we can pour molten iron into the pickaxe head cast and get an iron pickaxe. And to do that, we're going to have to get the actual cast, and the way you can do that, there are two ways you can do it. You can either pour gold over a cobblestone version of your tool, or you can pour aluminium brass, or aluminum brass if you're from the US, over the tool as well. So what we're going to go with is the aluminium brass, just because we don't have any gold just yet, and we do have a little bit of copper, as well as, I believe, a little bit of aluminium somewhere. Let me have a look here. Aluminium, is this it? No, it's not. Oh, it's here in my inventory. Okay, there we go. By the way, if you double-click on the NEI search bar, it starts to highlight anything that contains the characters that you type in. So if you want to search for something, that's a nice, easy way to do it. Or if you manage to get this and you want to get rid of it, just double-tap on the NEI search bar there. But if we craft up the materials in new Volume 1 book, we get materials in new Volume 2. And if we flick through here, I'm pretty sure it will show us the recipe for aluminium brass. I think, if my memory serves me right, it's 2 copper and 1 aluminium. I usually just go ahead and use gold whenever I make this these casts. So I'm going to have to check real quick here. But I'm pretty sure that the aluminium brass... Did I skip that there? I didn't. Okay, so I can't actually find it in materials and use. So I guess we're about to figure out whether or not this works. But before that, we do actually have to power the furnace, or the smeltery even. And the smeltery is powered on lava. Thankfully, we have this very nice volcano quite close to us. And so, if I was to just take these out of here, actually, we're kind of running a little low on fuel. But if I was to take those out of there and cook up this iron, we should be fairly easily able to grab some lava from that from the top of that volcano over there. I'm assuming there is. You can kind of see it on the minimap if I get rid of my death points. You should be able to see a little bit of lava kind of right there at the top. That's not like a waypoint or anything. That is actually just a little bit of lava right there. But yeah, I can't seem to find aluminium brass in here, and I also can't find it in NEI, which is a little weird. I'm fairly certain that Tinker's Construct is the mod that adds aluminium brass, but maybe not. Like, I can't see it here. And the reason why I can't find it is because I typed in aluminium and not aluminum. Aluminum has one less I in it than aluminium does, so obviously the mod author who made this is from the US. But the way that we make aluminum brass from Tinker's Construct is in the Tinker's Construct smeltery with... I think we might have to... Ooh, here it is. With... Let's see. Where is it? It is 3 aluminium brass to every 1 copper. It says 48 to 16 here, which is basically a 3 to 1 ratio. The opposite of what I thought, actually. So if we throw 3 into there with 1... If we throw 3 aluminium in with 1 copper ingot, how much is that going to get me? That is going to get me 64 millibuckets. I think... I'm not going to try and work that out based on that. I think a normal ingot is 144 millibuckets. So what we'll do... I'm hoping that by putting all that in, I'm fairly certain we'll get enough to make a cast. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to stick you for now right about there. Basically, we're going to pour aluminium brass over that, that axe head. But for now, let's quickly craft up this iron here into a bucket. Grab some of that lava from the volcano, like so. And now that we've got the bucket of lava, we can put that into the tank section, and we should now be able to smelt up the 3 aluminium and 1 copper that we need in order to make some aluminium brass. As you can see, the aluminium is smelting up pretty quickly. The copper is a little bit slow, but hopefully we'll make it in there. They should all be able to smelt with 1,000 millibuckets worth of lava. And then once that's done, we'll pour that over here. That's going to make a pickaxe head cast, and then after that, basically all we have to do is pour some iron into that cast, and that will get us an iron pickaxe head, which we can then put onto any kind of binding and any kind of rod we like. We'll probably end up going with a very similar setup, probably a paper binding and a normal wooden stick. There was really no point actually in me using a paper binding for the stone pickaxe, because in all honesty, we're not going to use this very long term. But let me quickly grab some iron here. That is going to get me 2 ingots worth of iron in the smeltery, so I might also go ahead and try and make another cast, dependent on how much aluminium brass we get. We got 8 ingots worth of aluminium brass, and I'm fairly certain it only takes 1 to make the cast. It does. Awesome. So let's throw the iron in there. That's going to get me 2 ingots worth. So we can make 1 into the pickaxe head cast. Let's also make, I guess, like a shovel, because we don't really need an axe just yet. We've got this iron axe over here, which is working just fine for us. But I am already getting a little bit bored of making shovels all the time. So let's just grab you and let's go ahead. Do we have any cobblestone left? I think we might. Oh, no, we've got some left. Cool. I thought we'd used it all in our furnaces. But let's take that and then we'll use this to make another mold so we can make ourselves a... an iron shovel as well. So we'll put you there. We'll pour that onto it. The iron is almost done. Let's switch this back out. I'm fairly certain that each one of these will have an ingot cost of 1. Yeah, it says material cost 1 and material cost 1, which means each of these will only use 1 ingot worth of iron in order to make the part. So we should be able to make both of these with the 2 iron that we have in there. So we'll put you in and pour that over as well. And then once we've got both of those, we can come back over to our little hut here. And we should be able to do pretty much the exact same thing that we've just done. So let's grab our binding. Let's grab 2 pieces of paper. We've already got 1 stick. We can make some more with some oak. And then we can craft all this stuff up in here. So part builder, I want to get 2 of these paper bindings. And then over here, we should just be able to craft 1 of those up into an iron pickaxe like so. And then craft the second one up into an iron shovel. Like so, and you actually don't need a binding for a shovel, so I did waste a little bit of paper there, but that's fine, we can put that in here, I'm sure we'll use it at some point in the future for something else. And now we have the ability to mine down deeper to get some redstone, some gold, some diamond, as well as the ability to shovel some sand, gravel, and clay a little bit faster as well. And so, what I'm gonna do, guys, I'm gonna go away, I'm gonna do a little bit more mining, and try and at least get some redstone and gold. I don't think we need diamonds for the ore doubling that I'm gonna do, and I'll be back in a second. And again, a little while later, I've done a bit more mining. We now have some redstone, some gold, a little bit of lead, and a tiny bit of silver and osmium as well. And so now what I want to do is set up an automatic ore doubling system so that we don't have to manually smelt up all of our ingots in the furnaces or manually throw all of our ingots through the smeltery. However, I am going to start by putting all of my ingots through the smeltery just because you get double the amount of ingots when you put the ores into the smeltery compared to when you put the ores into the normal vanilla furnaces. So let me quickly grab a seared brick out of here. You can use any ingot, but if you grab an ingot and throw it down into the casting table, you can make an ingot cast, and then you can actually just pull ingots directly out of the smeltery in ingot form. So if we do something like that, what we can do is put all of our iron into the smeltery. Those 9 iron ores are going to be smelted down into 18 iron ingots, which we can then pull out individually via the ingot cast here. And so what I'm going to do, guys, I'm going to go away, I'm going to smelt down a bunch of my ores into ingots, and I'll be back in a second to make some other machines to double my ores. Alright, so a little while later, I've smelted up 40 iron ingots as well as 4 copper ingots, and then over inside, I've also smelted up a little bit of gold and a little bit of osmium, and by that I just mean 1 of each. And what I would like to do now is set up some really early game ore doubling with Ender.io, because I feel like I never actually use Ender.io for my early game ore doubling. I always go with Industrial Craft 2 or Tinker's Construct or Thermal Expansion, when Ender.io has such a good system for ore doubling early on, and also has some conduits, which are surprisingly cheap compared to some of the other ones from Thermal Expansion and Industrial Craft 2. So we're going to start by making the alloy smelter over here. And for this, we need 3 normal furnaces, 4 iron ingots, 1 machine chassis, as well as a cauldron. So let's go ahead and start with the cauldron, I guess. We'll take you. We're also going to need 3 furnaces like so. And then as for the machine chassis, we're going to need some iron bars, as well as a basic capacitor, which looks a little bit like this. Let's see if memory serves me right. It's copper in the middle, and then golden nuggets all the way around the outside. We are going to need another one of these later on in today's episode, so I'm just going to go ahead and craft both of those right about now. We can then put the capacitor in the middle. We can put the iron bars, I think, around the outside, and then the iron bars in the middle. It's the other way around. You want to have the iron bars on the outside and the iron ingots on the inside. And again, we're going to need 2 of these in today's episode, so I'm just going to go ahead and craft those up as well. And that gets us 2 machine chassis. We can then go ahead and just craft all that stuff together to get ourselves the alloy smelter. Nice. And basically, this works like a furnace that can also craft metals together to make alloys. Pretty cool stuff. Now, in order to power it, we're obviously going to need some form of redstone flux. And we have the new version of Mechanism 9, installed within this mod pack. And so I would kind of like to tinker around with that a little bit. And one of the easiest ways of early game power is the heat generator. This guy over here, it's super easy to make. It is 3 iron ingots, 1 osmium ingot, 2 oak wood, 2 copper ingots, and then 1 furnace at the bottom there. All that stuff we have ready at our disposal. So if we just do something like this, we're missing the oak wooden planks, or really any kind of wooden plank should work. Can we craft slabs back into planks? We totally can. So we can go ahead and use all that stuff, craft ourselves a heat generator. What are we missing? We are missing the furnace? I thought we just crafted the furnace. But maybe I'm losing it. That gets us a heat generator. And basically, the way that the heat generator works is it produces power, only a very small amount of power, but it produces a renewable source of power if there is a source of heat nearby. So the way we're going to use it is we're going to first of all take it far away from any nearby trees and any nearby buildings, because we are going to start to work with a little bit of lava. And essentially what we're going to do is we're going to put this down and then surround it with lava. And also I realized whilst I was mining that these furious zombies actually get larger the more damage they take. I don't know why I'm fighting him with this thing. I've got a sword in my inventory. Let me do a little bit of running here. I don't have a sword in my inventory. It is in the chest inside. All right, well, we should let the sun do most of the work here. There we go. All right, those things are terrifying. My goodness. Just die. Jeez. All right, so now we got rid of that guy. Let me set up a bit of an example here. So we're going to have the heat generator for now, like right about here. Like I said, between episodes, I will work on getting a bit of a better looking base up and running. But we're going to do something like this. We're going to have lava here. We're going to have lava here. We're going to have lava here. But then we're also going to have lava on the top and the bottom. I'm not quite sure if all those sides count. Like, I don't know if the bottom will actually do anything or whether it just works on the area of this, like, little tank on the back. Or if that's just for looks, I'm not quite sure. But essentially, what we're going to do to start here is we're going to put the alloy smelter right about there, because that's where the heat generator outputs all of its redstone flux. I'm going to get rid of this tree. I'm going to do a quick couple of runs back and forward to the volcano to get some buckets of lava. I'm going to use those buckets of lava to put down the lava around the heat generator, and I'll be back in a second. Okay, so not so long later, we now have lava on all 3 sides of the heat generator, apart from the bottom and at the top. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to cover up the lava like so. And it's going to get a little bit messy here, but we're going to put lava on top like this. And now that generator should be generating a really, really small amount, but a passive amount of redstone flux. It's generating it without any fuel because it doesn't use up the lava. The lava is actually infinite. I'm actually going to cover this up as well, just in case it decides to start sparking and just makes the biggest forest fire ever. But you'll see that the amount of redstone flux inside of the alloy smelter here is going up, albeit very, very, very slowly. Now, the reason for that is because the power is being generated passively, free of charge. There is no fuel going into it. And so, ooh, I didn't want to do that. I wanted to go one more under so I could get to the bottom of this thing, just to show you what's going on in here. But now, if you look in here, you'll see it's producing 939 milli RF. It actually has a little M in front of the RF there, which means it's producing just shy of 1 redstone flux per tick. 1 redstone flux per tick would be 1,000 milli RF per tick. So not a lot at all. Actually, a ridiculously small amount of fuel being produced there. But one of the things that I really like about the heat generator is that it gives you the ability to have things powered passively. And by the way, I did some testing in a single player world, and it definitely does benefit from having lava below it as well. I think it goes up to about 2 point something redstone flux per tick. But it's also a very versatile generator because you can also put fuel into it, and you'll see that fuel gets then converted directly into lava, which then raises the amount of redstone flux being produced to about 36 and about 40 if you get the lava on the bottom here, a significantly higher number than the just under one redstone flux per tick that we were producing a second ago. And now what we can do is we can actually start to use this alloy smelter to smelt up our ingots. Now, on its own, the alloy smelter doesn't double ores. If I was to put some iron in here, it would just smelt it up into one iron ingot. And by the way, the machine does get faster the more power it has in its bank over here, so that would be faster normally. But that goes one iron ingot, boom! If we combine this up with a sag mill, the sag mill will turn all of our ores into dusts, into two dusts, which can then all be smelted into an ingot in the alloy smelter. So if we come back over to our crafting station, we type in sag mill, this guy over here, and you'll see why we needed the second machine chassis. This guy also requires three flint as well as a piston, so let's go ahead and grab three oak here. We've already got a little bit of cobblestone, although we do need two more in order to make a piston. So if we come back over, we should be able to craft that fairly easily, and then crafting the sag mill should be fairly easy as well. Nice. So we'll take this, and for now, we will put it down a little bit further forward, because I'm going to move the sag mill here, because right now, there's only one output for the heat generator, and only one machine can access it at any given time, whereas obviously, we would like both of these machines to be powered simultaneously, and so what I'm going to do, it's going to get a little bit cramped here, and like I said, between episodes, I will build a base and move all of this stuff, because it's all getting a bit cramped here, but just for proof of concept, we're going to have the alloy smelter be somewhere, ooh, you know what, let's put them like over here. We'll have the alloy smelter go there. We will have the sag mill go there. We do need to run power to both of these, and so we're going to use the conduits from Endwire as well, which are these guys over here. There are three different tiers, the energy conduit, the enhanced energy conduit, and then the ender energy conduit. We're going to go with the basic energy conduit. This is made with three conductive iron, which is made by smelting up some redstone and some iron in the alloy smelter. So if we do something like this, we need three of those and three of those. That should get us the three conductive iron. We also need six conduit binder, and we make that by smelting up binder composite, which is made using some gravel, some sand, and some clay. I did go ahead and grab a little bit more sand and a bit more gravel whilst I was waiting for all of my ingots to smelt up in the smelt tray, and I'm fairly certain we have some clay left over in here. We totally do. We can take that. We can craft all of that up into some of this binder composite, and then we can smelt up that binder composite into a bunch of conduit binder. I believe you get four conduit binder per piece of binder composite here, so that should get us a total of 32 conduit binder once it's all smelted up. But for now, all that we need is six conduit binder and three conductive iron, as well as probably a crafting station for outside, just so we don't have to run back and forth every time we want to craft something. So let's see, did that not, oh, do we run out of fuel? Seriously? All right, let's go ahead and smelt that up. And once we've got eight of that conduit binder, we can then craft that up without putting down our crafting station over by our alloy smelter. And that's going to allow us to run power from the heat generator, which should be getting a fairly nice amount of power there. You can see it's got 22,000 redstone flux backed up inside of it. So let's throw you down here. Let's do something like this. Conductive iron in the middle, the conduit binder around the outside like so. And then we can use these to carry the redstone flux from in there round to both of these machines. And then one of the really cool things that I like about the end of own machines is their ability to push and pull all of the items from adjacent inventories. I can see that creeper on the left there doing his head shake, flipping, thinking I can't see him. But unlike a lot of other machines, for example, thermal expansion machines can automatically output, but they can't automatically input. The end of IO machines can do both. So if we put down a chest here and we put down a chest here, what we can do is inside of the sag mill, we can go to configure IO, and then on the left-hand side here, use the left mouse button to move this around, and then you can use the right mouse button to set this to pull, push, or pull or slash push. We just want it set to pull, so it's going to pull all the items out of here into here. We then want to set this side of the sag mill to push, so it's going to push all the items out into the alloy smelter. I don't know if we have to set this to pull. I think the push from the sag mill will automatically send the items into there, but just for safe measure, we'll set that to pull as well, and then over here, we can set that to push, and now, if we go to sleep real quick so we don't get attacked by the furious zombies overnight, what we should be able to do is put all of our ores into the chest on the left, and they will automatically go straight from the chest to the sag mill, get turned into dust, then go from the sag mill to the alloy smelter, get smelted into ingots, and then from the alloy smelter into the end chest in their final doubled ingot form. Let's give it a go, shall we? So we'll throw all of our iron in there. That all got pulled in. The sag mill is now turning all of that iron into dust. Again, once it has some more power, it will run a little bit faster, but once that iron is turned into dust, it goes to the alloy smelter. The alloy smelter smelts it up, and then once it is done, it will end up over in this chest over here. A fully automatic pipeless auto-blinking system. There are no pipes or hoppers taking the items from one chest to another. It just goes all through the Ender IO machines. And as you probably saw just then, this guy can actually smelt up more than one dust at a time. This thing has actually stopped, probably due to the extreme low amount of power. Yeah, I don't think it's particularly fuel efficient in terms of the amount of like coal that it burns through very quickly. And we might all look towards a better solution for fuel pretty soon. But what I might actually do is just set up a couple of these in my new base that I'll make between episodes and see if they can make a little bit of power. Like, if we can get 20 of these set up, that's 20 free redstone flux per tick. That would be a little bit expensive for what we get. But as I was mentioning just there, let me see if I can throw in. Can I put wood in here? I can, okay. Let's throw a little bit of wood in just to try and get that through. And you'll see it's smelting both these up at a time. It's smelting two items at once, which is making it a little bit faster than maybe your typical redstone furnace or electric furnace from Industrial Craft 2. But with that, guys, I'm going to end this first episode of the Crack Pack there. As always, if you did enjoy the video, be sure to hit like. It really does help out a lot. Leave a comment down below, and I will see you guys next time.